Good morning and welcome back to our continuing study through the book of Revelation. Seven chapters down so far. Covered a lot of ground. Spent a lot of time and covered a lot of ground, and it's moving along now. Moving along a little bit quicker than it was. As we go on through the rest of it, some of it will go pretty quick. Last week we covered a whole chapter, and we have spent 3 weeks on one verse, so we're moving along a little steadier pace in some places than other, a little quicker pace, I should say, in some places than other. This week we are in chapter 8, and probably can get through this whole chapter before we're done, so without any further ado, let's just jump right in. Revelation chapter 8, starting in verse 1. And when he had opened the seventh seal, and I remember last week we did chapter 7, which is the first of the parenthetical chapters, and it falls in between the last, the sixth and the seventh seal. The sixth and seventh seal. And then we start with the trumpets. We finish off with the last seal, and then we start with the trumpets and move on into the bowls. And that's the basic timeline through the book of Revelation. So, verse 1, and when he had opened the seventh seal, there was silence in heaven about the space of half an hour. Now, this scripture here, when he opened the seventh seal, there was silence in heaven about the space of half an hour. Usually I go to this scripture to make a point that a lot of people don't like, but I use this scripture to prove that women can't go to heaven, because we all know that women can't be silent for half an hour. I'm only serious. I'm only kidding. Please don't send me emails. When he had opened the seventh seal, there was silence in heaven of about the space of half an hour. Comedy just don't come over when you're all alone by yourself. It don't happen for you when you're sitting in a room by yourself talking to a video camera, which is what I'm doing. This in opening of the seventh seal, there is a space of silence, a calm before the storm kind of feeling. John, of course, is experiencing this silence or quiet time from the perspective of heaven. He's seeing this from being in heaven. There is no indication in the Bible of how this silent time translates to and is perceived by those on the earth. This space of time is described by John as being about a half an hour. Now, whether or not this is a literal 30 minutes is the subject of many books and much arguing back and forth on the internet and what each one of these 30 minutes represents, and then on and on and on. God in his eternal and infinite wisdom has prepared all of these events that we read about in Revelation from the days of creation. He is fully prepared for all aspects of this entire plan. So I do not think the space is a time of preparation for any certain thing, as some say it is. There's a lot of teaching out there about how things are changing gears or changing momentum and changing things around in heaven because different things are starting to happen, and this is a preparation time for, like, kind of, I've read it online described as like if you're at a play and there's a scene change in the middle of the play, there's all kind of weird things. And that's the one thing about the internet is it opens you up to the weird ideas of every single individual in the world who has access to a computer. I mean, literally everybody who has a computer can post things on the internet and say, this is how it is, or thus saith God, or anything they want to say. That's just it. That's why we got to have a standard. We have to have a standard. We have to have a rule book. We have to have a moral authority. And this is it. And this is the only thing it can be. Everything else is garbage. Everything else is trash. So I don't think this is, this is a preparation time. I don't think it's a set change. I don't think any of these things. There is an entire avenue of study in the comparison of the events in the book of Joshua as a prelude to an outline of the events in the book of Revelation. Now, there's a big, long study involved in this, but let me just go over a few high points of a comparison of the book of Joshua with the book of Revelation. The book of Joshua is a tale about a military leader who leads the people of God in cleansing the land of usurpers. So is the book of Revelation. It's about the people of God himself, cleansing the land through war and skirmishes. Canaan originally had 10 tribes. three of these tribes were dealt with and done away with, and seven tribes were left. Remember in chapter 13, when we get to it, we got the animal with 10 crowns, 10 horns, and a little horn rises up and does away with three of them and leaves seven, and the little one is the eighth. Number three, crossing of the Jordan took place on the 10th of Nisan. That's the date. Circumcision by Joshua then took place on the 14th of Nisan. Jesus' triumphal entry was on the 10th of Nisan, and he was crucified on the 14th of Nisan. Number four, Joshua met the captain of the host, or the captain of the armies, in Jericho. In Revelation 19, Jesus leaves heaven on a white horse, leading the armies of God. Number five, several aspects of the Torah is ignored at Jericho. The ark was not to be used in battle, but in Jericho, it was out in front of everybody else. The Levites were exempt from military service, but at Jericho, the Levites led the way. They carried the ark and led the way. Rest on the seventh day, Sabbath, that's an absolute must. Rest on the seventh day. At Jericho, they did seven times the amount of work that they did on the previous 6 days on the Sabbath, on the seventh day. Number six, two spies were sent in ahead of time. Rahab was saved in the process. This makes them two witnesses who went in ahead of the battle. Remember, we have two witnesses coming up that stand on the Temple Mount declaring what's coming from God. Number seven, 6 days they marched around Jericho. For 6 days they marched around the city one time in absolute silence. The children of Israel did around the city of Jericho. On the seventh day, they marched around the city seven times. And on the seventh, all the trumpets are sounded and all the shouts are given. Six seals are broken. In comparison, the six seals are broken. And on the seventh seal, there is silence in heaven before the sounding of the trumpets. Number eight. After Jericho, their leaders gathered themselves under a man called Adonizedek, which means the Lord our righteousness. All the men in Revelation bow and come under rule of the one who calls himself the God of gods, or who's above all gods. Eventually, Adonizedek is defeated by signs and wonders in the sun and the moon. After he is defeated, all the kings hide themselves in caves and beg the rocks to fall on them. Number 11, Joshua institutes Jubilee year and calls it the restoration of all things. In Acts chapter 3, Peter refers to the second coming of Christ as the restoration of all things. Now, there's a much deeper Bible study that you can go into and get into that. But the fact of the business is there's a comparison between the two. And the biggest, and the reason I pointed all that out is because of this silence in heaven, this silence, this prelude, this calm before the storm, however you want to refer to it. In Joshua 6, verse 10 through 16, it says, "And Joshua had commanded the people, saying, You shall not shout, nor make any noise with your voice, neither shall any word proceed out of your mouth until the day that I bid you to shout. Then shall you shout. So the ark of the Lord compassed the city, going about it once. And they came into the camp and lodged in the camp. And Joshua rose early in the morning, and the priests took up the ark of the Lord, and seven priests bearing seven trumpets of ram's horns before the ark of the Lord went on continually and blew with the trumpets. And the armed men went before them, but the rearward came after the ark of the Lord, the priests going on and blowing with the trumpets. And the second day they compassed the city once and returned into the camp. So they did for 6 days. And it came to pass on the seventh day that they rose early about the dawning of the day and compassed the city after the same manner seven times. Only on that day they compassed the city seven times. And it came to pass at the seventh time, when the priests blew with the trumpets, Joshua said to the people, Shout, for the Lord hath given you the city." So there was a calm, there was a silence, there was a period of silence that went on before Jericho came down. And like I said, up until this point, the things that are happening on the earth have happened because it can be related to mankind, that happened on the face of the earth, wars and things of that nature, famine and pestilence and those things. But from this point forward, we're going to see the judgments. We're going to see the things of God coming on the earth, coming out of the sky, coming out of heaven, being poured out onto the earth, in other words. For 6 days, the people marched around the city in silence. And once they had once they had come past the city, the trumpet sounded, which is quiet before the trumpets. In comparison, in the first six seals, the damage and effects of the earth have come about in a vague sort of way. As far as heaven is concerned, the four horsemen brought about widespread calamity through wars and the destruction that come about during times of war. War ravages nations as it moves through the lands where it's being waged. The destruction upon the earth as a result of these wars will be vast and swift. Remember, all 21 of the judgments of God upon the earth take place in a seven-year period. That's a short amount of time, with most of them being in the last 3.5 years or the last half of that time frame. Still, because of the nature of the first seven seals, mankind can look upon them as being man-made. He can and will blame himself for what is happening at times and what is transpiring. Just as all wars of the past on the planet Earth may be blamed for the destruction that they were responsible for. The opening of the seventh seal, however, brings about an obvious change in what is happening and how it is happening. Beginning with the first trumpet and ending with the seventh bowl or vile judgment, the devastations, calamities, and destruction start to either fall from the skies or come up out of the ground. And mankind sees a definite shift in the nature of the violence. When this happens, men begin to blame and to curse God. So, does this silence have anything to do with this? Absolutely. It does, or otherwise it wouldn't be mentioned in there. What exactly, how can it be described? The Bible's vague and silent on it. So we just have to take it for what it is. We just have to take it that there's a little short space. John calls it the space of about a half an hour, and there's complete and total silence. Just think about that. There is complete and total silence in heaven. Remember all the things that we've read about that are going on, the people that are there, the angels that are there, the commotion, just the controlled chaos of millions and millions of people being present in an open space. The lightnings, the thunders, the storms, the decoration, the four living beasts that are around the throne, all these things become silent. Everything goes silent. It was silence, he said. That word silent, it means just that, silent, absolute quiet silence for about a half an hour. Is it so everybody can get grasp a feeling of the impending doom? I don't know. Whatever. You can read into it whatever you will. Verse 2, and I saw seven angels which stood before God, and to them were given seven trumpets. Around and in front of God's throne, we have seven spirits, the pneuma, that stand before the throne. Four beasts are living creatures, which is the Zoa. We talked about that too. Here, we also see seven angels, angelos, A-N-G-O-L-O-S. All these are described as being different from each other. There is no reason at all to assume that these are all different representations of the same things. This speaks of seven of these angels, archangels, that have direct access to the throne of God. The Bible only names two of these archangels. In Jude chapter 1, verse 9, it says, yet Michael, the archangel, when contending with the devil, he disputed about the body of Moses, durst not bring any railing against him or accusation, but said, the Lord rebuke thee. And then in Luke chapter 1, verse 19, it says, and the angel answering said unto him, I am Gabriel, that stand in the presence of God, and am sent to speak unto thee, and to show thee these glad things. Now, in the book of Tobit, I'm going to talk about the book of Tobit, which is in the Apocrypha, and also the book of Enoch, both of that's not in the Apocrypha. The book of Tobit, also known as Tobias, is one of the books of the Apocrypha. It lists another archangel. In Tobit 12, verse 15, it says this, for I am the angel Raphael, one of the seven who stand before the Lord. In the book of Enoch now, the book of Enoch lists all seven, the names of all seven of these angels. Enoch chapter 20, it can be found in chapter 20 of the book of Enoch. And these are the names of the holy angels who watch. Uriel, one of the holy angels who is over the world and over Tartarus. Raphael, one of the holy angels who is over the spirits of men. Raguel, one of the holy angels who takes vengeance on the world of the luminaries. Michael, one of the holy angels, to wit, he that is set over the best part of mankind and over chaos. Sarakiel, one of the holy angels who is set over the spirits who sin in the spirit. Gabriel, one of the holy angels who is over paradise and the serpents and the cherubim. And Remiel, R-E-M-I-E-L, one of the holy angels whom God set over those who rise The book of Tobit and Enoch are both, of course, outside of the Bible. The information found in them is not necessarily questionable, but it cannot be given the full confidence that is accorded to the canon of the Holy Bible. Because of the descriptions of the interactions between Michael and Daniel in the book of Daniel, Michael is seen as the guardian or the defender of the nation of Israel. Now, remember, the book of Enoch listed Michael as one of the holy angels, to wit, he is set over the best part of mankind. And the book of Daniel calls him the representative of your people, or the people of Israel. Likewise, because of the description of Gabriel announcing to Mary the miracle of the virgin birth, Gabriel is seen as a news or an announcement. He's an angel of announcement. This is where the idea comes from of the blowing of Gabriel's horn, announcing the return of Christ, you know, the trumpet. 1 Thessalonians 4 and 16 says this, "For the Lord himself," that's Jesus Christ, "shall descend from heaven with a shout, making noise, with the voice of the archangel." Which archangel? We're surmising here that this is Gabriel, the announcement angel, that he makes announcements with the voice of the archangel and with the trump of God. "And the dead in Christ shall rise first." The Bible doesn't actually name the archangel by name, nor does it say that the archangel will be the one blowing the trump of God. Just another assumption by mankind of things attributed to the Bible that aren't in the Bible. These seven angels which were seen by John are trusted angels. Whether they are of any official or higher order than common angels is not stated, other than that they stand before the throne of God. The only thing that we're made aware of here is that they have access to being close to or near the throne of God. Now, when you look at the people who are dressed in white robes and righteousness, when the Bible describes them as seeing them surrounding the throne, there's not necessarily any reason to assume that the people who are closest to the throne died in better standing with God than the people who are, let's say, 100 rows back or 1,000 rows back, or who are in the nosebleed section, or whatever, however you want to refer to it. There's nothing in the Bible that assumes that that's the case. Because, listen to me, be very clear about this. What we imagine it's going to be like to stand before the throne of God, whether we're in row one or row 1,000, we can't. There's no way that we can, in our minds, in our Mickey Mouse little minds, we cannot assume to understand what it's going to be like to be in the presence of God. And I'm fully convinced within myself. Everybody's entitled to their own opinion, but I'm fully convinced and within myself that I will be just as satisfied being in row 10,000 as I would be in row 1. But here, these angels, the hierarchy, the pecking order, if you will, these things are laid out now before all that comes about. He sees these angels, these four beings, these four living beings, these elders that surround the throne, these seven angels, the other things that have upfront access, they're there ministering and serving the throne. That's what they're doing. They're not standing there as a reward, as being able to be in the presence of God. They are actually ministering and doing things before the throne. Within their ranks, within their personages, there is a hierarchy. Although, just like with the elders, the whole discussion with the elders, we really don't have access to understand why. And with good reason, in my mind, because we would all spend our entire lives trying to do everything we could to be one of them 24. Instead of just doing the will of God and trying to get to heaven and being with Him for through all eternity. But there is an established order of some kind, but it's not laid out to us, because everything, believe it or not, is not our business. It's not for us to understand every tiny little tiny thing. That's a misnomer that's taught a lot. That, you know, that we have full access now. We do not have full access now. If we had full access now, we would have full access to our minds, which would make us capable of having full access now. We cannot handle the truth, in the words of a famous movie. The events that transpire at the soundings of the trumpet are well beyond the rapture and the saints in chapter 4, verse 1. Neither do they have anything to do with the Old Testament. There are seven trumpets which will be blown by seven angels in the order as given, and after the seven seals and before the seven vials. When each is blown, certain judgments, certain things, certain events will transpire on the earth. They are to be blown successively, and each after the preceding one has been completed. The first will be blown soon after the seventh seal, and the last on towards the middle of the week, of the second week. Oh, okay, back to Revelation 8, verse 3. Let's catch up. And when he had opened the seventh seal, there was silence in heaven for about the space of half an hour. And I saw seven angels which stood before God, and to them were given seven trumpets. Verse 3. And another angel, pay close attention to this, another angel. Another angel came and stood at the altar, having a golden censer. And there was given unto him much incense, that he should offer it with the prayers of all the saints upon the golden altar which was before the throne. And another angel, so this is separate, this is another angel separate from the seven, another angel was spoken, and he had a golden censer. Now, this Leviticus chapter 16, verse 12 through 14 says this, and he shall take a censer full of burning coals of fire from off of the altar before the Lord, and his hands full of sweet incense, beaten small, and bring it within the veil. And he shall put the incense upon the fire before the Lord, that the cloud of the incense may cover the mercy seat that is upon the testimony. This is talking about the high priest going into the end and going into the Holy of Holies, that the incense may cover the mercy seat that is upon the testimony, that he die not. And he shall take of the blood of the bullock and sprinkle it with his finger upon the mercy seat eastward, and before the mercy seat shall he sprinkle the blood with his finger seven times. Only the high priest was ever associated with having the golden censer and approaching the Ark of the Covenant, which was inside the Holy of Holies. Only the high priest, nobody else. And then he only did that one day, one time, on one special day per year. This angel that is approaching God's throne and the fire before the throne is acting in the office of the high priest. In heaven, there has always only been one high priest. Hebrews 4, 14 and 15 says this, seeing then that we have a great high priest that is passed into the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast our profession. For we have not an high priest which cannot be touched with the feeling of our infirmities, but was in all points tempted just like we are. Now this, he had another angel came and stood at the altar having a golden censer. This golden censer, the golden altar of incense, stood just outside the veil, first in the tabernacle and then in both of the temples as well. The fires were to remain burning day and night and never allowed to go out. The smoke rising continually represented the prayers of the people. Now, listen to what it said here. I saw the seven angels which stood before God, and to them were given seven trumpets. And another angel, this is Christ Jesus. This is Christ Jesus in heaven acting in the office of the high priest. Another angel came and stood at the altar having a golden censer. And there was given unto him much incense, that he should offer it with the prayers of all the saints upon the golden altar which was before the throne. It's before the throne. Exodus chapter 30, verse 6 through 8 says, and thou shalt put it before the veil that is by the ark of the testimony, before the mercy seat that is over the testimony, where I will meet with thee. And Aaron shall burn thereon sweet incense every morning when he dresseth the lamps. He shall burn incense upon it. And when Aaron lighteth the lamp at evening, he shall burn incense upon it, a perpetual incense before the Lord throughout your generations. This angel came and he stood at the altar having a golden censer. This is the high priest. He is in the office. He's acting in the office of the high priest. All these things are going to be scattered on the face of the earth. We're going to see that here again in a minute. This is Jesus Christ. This is the representation of Jesus acting in the office of the high priest in the heaven on that day. Verse 4, and the smoke of the incense which came with the prayers of the saints ascended up before God out of the angel's hand. The coals or the fire that burned on the altar of incense was carried inside the tabernacle from the altar of sacrifice outside by the high priest. The fire that burned continually on the altar of sacrifice was lit or started by God himself. Leviticus 9:24 says, and there came a fire out from before the Lord and consumed upon the altar the burnt offering and the fat, which when all the people saw, they shouted and fell on their faces. Any fire from any other source that was burning, that was brought to, or if it went out and it went away, it was considered strange fires, forbidden. Leviticus chapter 10, verse 1 and 2 says this, and Nadab and Abihu, the sons of Aaron, took either of them his censer and put the fire therein and put incense thereon and offered strange fire before the Lord, which he commanded them not. And there went out fire from the Lord and devoured them. And they died before the Lord. You weren't allowed this strange fire. You couldn't put fire, strange fire. You couldn't let it go out. The fire was lit by God, and it was intended to be burnt by God. The only time the high priest was the only person who was ever allowed to approach and do the incense and go inside the Holy of Holies and approach the Ark of the Covenant. He was the only one that was ever allowed to do that. Revelation 8 verse 5, and the angel took the censer and lifted it and filled it with the fire of the altar and cast it into the earth, and there were voices and thunderings and lightnings and an earthquake. He took the fire and the censer and he cast it into the earth. This angel, our high priest Jesus Christ, approached the altar that burns before God with his golden censer full of fire from the sacrificial altar in front of the temple in heaven, giving much incense, which is the prayers of the saints, which include Adam, Noah, Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, John the Baptist, Peter, James, John, Paul, Kent, you, and everybody else. The prayers of the saints. That's what he's coating around. It's what he's going. Who do we pray to? Who do we pray in the name of? Jesus Christ. Do we pray to anybody else? No, we're not allowed to pray to anybody else. Do we pray in the name of anybody else? No, we don't pray in the name of anybody else. Do we make suppositions to anyone but the Son of God, Jesus Christ? No, we do not. We do not make suppositions to any of them. And he is the one who receives our prayers. He's the one that we pray to. And it's his name, the power of his name, that causes our prayers to be acted upon, period. Nobody else, none other. He poured the fire and the smoke of prayer out before God the Father. Then taking the fire off the altar that burns before the Lord, he cast it into the earth. Incidentally, this fire that burns before the throne of God used to be the appointed place of Lucifer. This used to be his tromping grounds. This before he fell, this is where he walked. In Ezekiel chapter 28, verse 13 to 15, it says this, thou hast been in Eden, the garden of God. Every precious stone was thy covering, the sardis, topaz, and the diamond, the beryl, the onyx, the jasper, the sapphire, the emerald, the carbuncle, and gold. The workmanship of thy tabrets and pipes, or the music, was prepared in thee. It was created. Remember, we've talked about that before. Satan is music. Music is a literal part of him. It is created within him. It is inside him. His pipes and his tabrets. And when he walked, he would walk before the presence of God. And when he walked, the music would play. The music, the air whistling through him, moving through him, moving around him, would create the music as it walked. So always bear that in mind. Satan is music. Satan does not just use music to trap our teenagers, to trap our kids. Satan don't just use music to affect us spiritually. I mean, you ain't got to listen to a country music station very long at all before you crying and ready to shoot somebody. There's a reason for that. That music is being used against you. It's being used against you. More of our teenagers commit suicide, go on drugs, walk around depressed, turn into goths and gothic, and just have no hope. They've got no hope. And it, but simply because they subject themselves, or they are being subjected to Satan through his music. He don't just use music. He is music. Always keep that in mind. Thy tabrets and thy pipes was prepared in thee in the day that you was created. Thou art the anointed cherub that covereth, and I have set thee so. Thou wast upon the holy mountain of God. Thou hast walked up and down in the midst of the stores of the stones of fire. Thou wast perfect in thy ways from the day that thou was created till iniquity was found within thee. Remember, in Revelation 5 and 8, the four living creatures and the 24 elders, they all offer prayers to God as well. Revelation 5 and 8, and when he had taken the book, the four beasts and the 24 elders fell down before the Lamb, having every one of them harps and golden vials full of odors, which are the prayers of the saints. He took these things and he cast them into the earth. Fearful calamities were about to come upon the earth. They are about to come upon the earth. Even the prayers of the saints cannot prevail or turn them away. And now the symbol of the scattered coals indicated the terrible judgments which were about to come upon the world. Compare that to Ezekiel's command to scatter fire in the city of Jerusalem as the Spirit of God deserted the temple. Ezekiel chapter 10, starting in verse 2. And he spake unto the man clothed with linen. Again, here we have another man clothed with linen. We got this guy, this angel, walked up to this angel of righteousness, walked up to the throne. And he spake unto the man clothed with linen, another version of Jesus Christ. It's called a Christophany. Anytime you see Jesus in the Old Testament, it's a Christophany. The man clothed with linen, and he said, go in between the wheels, even under the cherub, and fill thy hand with coals of fire from between the cherubims, and scatter them over the city. And he went in my sight. Now the cherubim stood on the right side of the house when the man went in, and the cloud filled the inner court. Then the glory of the Lord went up from the cherub and stood over the threshold of the house. And the house was filled with the cloud, and the court was full of the brightness of the Lord's glory. And the sound of the cherubim's wings was heard even to the outer court, as the voice of the Almighty God when he speaketh. And it came to pass that when he had commanded the man clothed with linen, saying, take fire from between the wheels, from between the cherubims. Then he went in and he stood beside the wheels, and one cherub stretched forth his hand from between the cherubims unto the fire that was between the cherubims, and took thereof and put it into the hands of him that was clothed with linen, who took it and went out. And there appeared in the cherubims the form of a man's hand under their wings. And when I looked, behold, the four wheels by the cherubims, one wheel by one cherub and another wheel by another cherub. And the appearance of the wheels was as the color of a beryl stone. He went in, he was commanded to this man in white linen, who's Jesus Christ, to go in and to take fire. Remember, this is the destruction of the temple and the casting away to the Babylonian pit, to the Babylonian, when they were cast into Babylon, to the Babylonian, when they were sent away, and the temple was destroyed the first time. He said, go in, take fire from this machine, this vision of God's throne is what it is that Ezekiel saw. Take fire and scatter it amongst the city. Here in the book of Revelation, we have that same man, Christ Jesus, that same person, Christ Jesus, our Savior, our high priest, the only one who walked around with a censer in his hand, our high priest was taken in and told to get fire, and he cast it into the earth, the representation of Christ among the things. So from this point forward, these things are coming from heaven. They're coming from God. They cannot be no longer the things on earth. Can be blamed on man or global warming or climate change or whatever it is they're blaming it on still in those days. And wars and people being mad at each other. Now the things are going to start coming out of the sky. The judgments are going to be obviously and without doubt coming from God, from heaven, from the throne. Judgments of God on the earth. And the seven angels which had the seven trumpets prepared themselves to sound. Once he did that, this earthquake, there was the voice of an earthquake. Voices and thunderings and lightning and earthquakes. All these things, all of these things are associated with the throne of God. We went over that before. Revelation 4 and 5, and out of the throne proceeded lightnings, thunderings, and voices. Revelation 11:19, and the temple of God was opened in heaven, and there was seen in the temple the ark, and there were lightnings and voices and thunderings and an earthquake and great hail. Revelation 16:17-18, the seventh angel poured out his vial into the air, and there came a great voice out of the temple of heaven from the throne saying, "It is done." And there were voices and thunders and lightnings, and there was a great earthquake, such as was not since men were upon the earth. So mighty an earthquake and so great. So here we are, we're underway, we're started. Verse 6, and the seven angels which had the seven trumpets prepared themselves to sound. Verse 7, the first angel sounded, and there followed hail and fire mingled with blood. This is a reminiscent of one of the plagues in Egypt. Several of these are, as a matter of fact. Exodus 9, verses 22 through 26 says this, and the Lord said unto Moses, stretch forth thy hand toward heaven, and there may be hail in all the land of Egypt, upon man and upon beast and upon every herb of the field throughout the land of Egypt. And Moses stretched forth his rod towards heaven, and the Lord sent thunder and hail, and fire ran along the ground. And the Lord rained hail upon the land of Egypt, so that there was hail and fire mingled with hail. Very grievous, such as there was none like it in all the land of Egypt since it became a nation. And the hail smote throughout all the land of Egypt, all that was in the field, both man and beast. And the hail smote every herb of the field and brake every tree of the field. Only in the land of Goshen, where the children of Israel were, there was no hail. This stuff is gonna come raining down on the face of the earth. It's gonna rain down on the entire globe. It's not just the people of Egypt anymore. It's the whole world. It's the whole globe. This is the end of all things. This is the way it's all gonna come down. The first angel sounded, and there followed hail and fire mingled with blood, and they were cast upon the earth. And the third part of the trees was burnt up, and all green grass was burnt up. That's verse 7, and cast upon the earth. The events of the seven trumpets, starting with this hailstorm, and it's like I said, it reminisced back. And what did it say? It said, and the hail smote throughout all the land of Egypt, all that was in the field, both man and beast, and the hail smote every herb, all their food, every herb of the field, and break every tree in the field, all their food trees. We're going to get to that. It's the same exact thing that's going to happen over. Only in the land of Goshen, where the children of Israel were, was there no hail. The events of the seven trumpets are just as literal as the revelation gives them. We need to keep reminding ourselves that this book is a revelation. It is a unveiling. It is an opening up. It is a revealing of things that are to come. Not spiritual things, of things that are to come. We should always see that what is contained in it is it described, unless it is abundantly clear that it is a representation of some sort or another. There is no reason to make these events spiritual instead of real or literal. There's no reason to think that all these things that are coming are something other than what they are. If it says an earthquake, it's going to be an earthquake. If it says hailstones are raining down out of the sky, hailstones are going to be raining down out of the sky, and they're going to be mingled with blood and fire, just like they were before, just like they were in the days of Egypt. The plagues in Egypt were literal. They were very literal. They happened just exactly as they were described. So there was no reason for these not to be considered literal as well. There here is, and I'm going to give you a few examples of things that mankind read into these actual events that we're going to read about. The earthquake in Revelation chapter 6 as the breaking up of society. These are the things that men say that these descriptions in Revelation actually describe, and not, and when it says an earthquake, it don't mean the earth is going to literally shake. It means that's the breaking up of society. The sun darkened. That's Christ is rejected and God has been dethroned. The moon turned to blood as the destruction of derived authority. That when all authority goes away, the moon turning to red describes the authority being taken over and nobody respecting authority anymore. The stars falling as the downfall of all the religious leaders. Yeah. The heavens departing as the destruction of organized Christianity. So they'll do anything, they'll believe anything to not believe the Bible, even the church. Even the teachers, even the doctrinites, even the people who get in here and so-called represent God and so-called teach the Word of God, they get in here and they decide that the Word of God is not really, doesn't say what the Word of God means. And they continue on to describe to you what they assume or what they think or what they believe the Word of God means. And because they can't get outside of their little mind, they can't get outside of their own intelligence, they can't get outside of their theology or their degrees that they received from seminary or whatever the case may be. Whatever the case may be, they have to impart to it some kind of intellectual thing that misrepresents the story, the doctrine, the Word of God itself, the actual Word of God. It's unbelievable. The heavens departing as the destruction of organized Christianity, the grass in Revelation 8 and 7 as this common people, just common people. The trees describe the dignity of man, not trees, it describes the dignity of man. The burning mountain in Revelation 8:8 is a spiritual Babylon, which is cast into the Sea of Nations. The star fallen from heaven is the Pope. The dark, see everything, and that's another thing. Everything, if everything is just historical, if you read in the Book of Revelation as history, as a description of historical events that have already happened, it all has to do with Rome. It has everything about it has to do with Rome, the leaders of Rome, the Pope. The archbishops, the whatever, it's all Roman in nature. It all has all to do with Rome. Not Israel, not Christ, not God's people, Rome. It's all historical description of Rome. That baffles me. The darkening of the planets in Revelation 8 and 12 is spiritual darkness, which covers the earth. The key, remember, he comes down with the key, the bottomless pit, as a political or religious system that opens up the pit of evil in man's hearts, kind of, so to speak. The darkness in Revelation 9, 2 is blotting out of the true light in man's spiritual awareness or his spiritual sky or whatever. The locust is the spread of false religions, not locusts, just false religions. The 200 million man army is people that have overrun Europe and Asia. And they could possibly be Muslim, but there's a lot of argument and nobody really understands. The sores that are described as a spiritual plague, you know, and the sea and the rivers turning to blood are believed to be the drying up of the source of life or the drying up of spirituality or mysticism or religion in general. The Euphrates River drying up in Revelation 16:12 is the drying of the Turkish Empire, the Ottoman Empire. So that's what I'm saying. It's all historical. And the earthquake in Revelation 16 as the destruction of religious institutions. Why should we think that these misguided and convoluted guesses are clearer and easier to understand than taking the events literally as written? How could all of these things be, such as Europe being overrun by man over many centuries, when all the events from Revelation 4:1 are on after the churches? We went through that thoroughly. We discussed that thoroughly. How could the Pope of Rome fall from heaven several different times? How does he get up there in the first place? What elevates the Pope to have a position to be placed as a star, as anything in the sky? And how does he fall? These interpretations could not possibly be the true meaning of these many events. Again, we're simplistic. We're just like the ignorant sheep herders that the Bible was written for, or at least I am. I speak for myself. And the Book of Revelation was not there. So, like I said in the beginning, God didn't throw the Book of Revelation in at the end so that the elite and the highly intellectual and the ones who took the time to go to theology school and seminary would have something to talk about and discuss at cocktail parties in an intellectual way. That is not what the Book of Revelation was there for. It was there as a guide to the common man, just like everything else in the Bible is a guide to not just the common man, to every man. To every man, whosoever will. Not some intellectual elite, not some special group of people that can only interpret and pass it on to the masses. How very Latin and Catholic Church is that? None of those things. There's no reason that we should take these things and turn them into things that they are not, and twist and turn and gobble up the Book of Revelation to the point that now most of the church won't recognize or won't teach teach the book of Revelation because they're afraid of it. Because there are so many different things out there about the book of Revelation that most people just look at it and go, I just love Jesus. I just want to share the love of Jesus. That's where that feeling comes from. It's a feeling of loss and a feeling of being overwhelmed at the information that's there, because you have all these people saying, I know it says this, but here's what it really means. Let me show you what it really means. And they go into all this gobbledygook and they write 9 different books to describe to you a book. Again, I go back to Steve Hess so many times. Why read a book about a book? Just read the book. This is the only book that you have the author with you, present with you, in the room with you, anytime you ever pick it up and read it. And if there's anything in here you don't understand, all you have to do is just look up and say, hey, excuse me, I need a little help here. And guess what? He will help you. That's what he is there for. That's what he does. It's not an imposition to ask the Holy Ghost to declare to you some truth in the Word of God if you're possibly having trouble understanding it. Back to verse 7. The first angel sounded, and there followed hail and fire mingled with blood, and they were cast upon the earth. And the third part of the trees were burnt up, and all the green grass was burnt up. The first four trumpets all seem to deal with the substance of mankind. Although many men have interpreted trees and grass as symbolic of every whim of their imagination, realistically and simply, these two things refer to the destruction of food supplies. Let me say that again. They refer to the destruction of food supplies. A third part of the trees of the earth, firstly, would affect the supply of oxygen. Trees are the primary tool that the earth, that God and all of his glory and wisdom, trees are the primary tool that he uses to give us oxygen. They convert carbon dioxide into breathable oxygen. One tree provides 24 hours worth of oxygen for 4 people. One tree, one good-sized pine tree, will provide 24 hours worth of oxygen for 4 different people. Trees would also include fruit trees and food trees. Destruction of a third of all the fruit and nut trees would vastly cut food supplies. Concerning the green grass, this is more than just lawns. It's not talking about lawns and golf courses and public parks and things like that. It's, again, it refers to food grasses, wheat, rye, barley, oats, rice, buckwheat, and even corn. Corn is considered a grass. One website that I looked at had 9,000 species of edible grass that are available on Earth. 9,000 different species of edible grasses. So that's what this destruction of trees and the grass, that's what this is referring to. It's referring to food supplies, the things that people eat. This would represent a third of all this would represent a huge shortage of food. Going hand in hand with this, remember that an enormous amount of animal life gets its entire diet from trees and grasses. Think of all the animals on the face of the earth that don't eat meat. All they eat is grass and eat out of the trees. All those animals, there will be extremely hungry animals when this happens. There are going to be a lot of hungry animals roaming the face of the earth. And guess what? Hungry animals usually represents dead people. Usually those two go hand in hand. Hungry animals equals dead people. They'll be flying over and walking the face of the earth looking for food in a world where a huge chunk of their food supplies are gone. So this is more than, you know, it's more than just killing off the grass. It's more than just, you know, people's front yards dying out. It's a lot of different things. It goes way beyond that. Verse 8, and the second angel sounded, and there was, as it were, a great mountain burning with fire, which is a meteor, of course. It was cast into the sea, and the third part of the sea became blood. Now, first of all, let me point out that a third part of the sea became blood. Now, that means that the waters became blood. So naturally, you know, whatever's in the water, whatever fish is in the water, of course, is going to die because they can't live off blood. But think about this. The sea moves. There's currents. There's ocean currents. And the sea is always moving. So initially, when that meteor hits the sea and a third of it becomes blood, it's going to be that. It's going to be a third part of the oceans become blood. But eventually, as time goes on, it's going to, the rest of the sea is going to be enveloped. It's going to be affected by it. So you can't just cut a slice off of it and say a third of the sea turns to blood and the rest of it stays okay. You can't look at it from that because you got ocean currents. It's going to be affected. It's going to leach into it. A third part of the sea became blood. The surface of the earth is three-fourths covered in oceans, and one-third of that would basically be the entire Atlantic basin, everything in that area. Verse 9, and the third part of the creatures which were in the sea and had life died, and the third part of the ships were destroyed. A lot of third parts here, a lot of one-third, and things cut up into thirds. The creatures in the sea, first of all, ocean fishing accounts for 80% of the world's fish catch. Ocean fishing, not rivers and streams, ocean, saltwater fishing. The other 20% comes from, 5% is inland fishing, and aquaculture accounts for about 15%. 95% of all ocean catches occur in coastal waters. Let me read that again. 95% of all ocean catches, all the fishing, all the commercial fishing that goes on, occurs in coastal waters. One-fourth of the world's ocean fish catch is also used to feed animals. It's not people food, it's animal food. According to this, the website that I was looking at, 80% of all the fish consumed by man comes from the ocean, and a third of that will be instantly killed. So you divide 80 by a third, and you got whatever that works out to be, 23% of all the world's food supply will be instantly cut off. And eventually it'll keep going. Like I said, that blood will spread. Now again, a third of the ships are destroyed. And you know, for years, I've heard people read that verse, and I've heard people talk about it. And you think, well, what's the big deal with the boats? Why destroy the ships? And why a third of the ships? Why destroy them? Well, you got to look into it a little bit. This is what I found out. As of December 31st, 2013, which is almost 2 years ago now, there are somewhere between 75,000 and 80,000 commercial ships registered and doing business at any given time. 75 and 80,000 ships. This figure does not include military vessels, cruise ships, or any small privately owned commercial haulers, nothing small, nor does it include any private leisure craft of any size. At any given time, there is approximately 175 billion tons of products of every imaginable kind making its way across the waters of the earth. Let me repeat that. 175 billion tons are afloat at any given time. Now remember, these figures are 2 years old, so this is obviously, it's increased, probably not by a wide margin, but it's increased since then. Of that tonnage that's en route at all the time, approximately, and get this, one-third of that, approximately one-third is made up of edibles or food. So of the 175 billion tons of goods that are afloat right now, one-third of it is food. Is that a coincidence? I don't know. I don't think so. I don't believe in coincidence. I've said this before. There is no Hebrew word for a coincidence. It does not exist. The Bible isn't specific here exactly what force will be used to destroy these maritime vessels. However, in other scriptures, it speaks of destruction of water vessels and ships. In Psalm 48, verse 7, it says, "Thou breakest the ships of Tarshish with an east wind." In Ezekiel 27, starting in verse 24, for it says, "These were thy merchants in all sorts of things, in blue clothes and broidered work, and in chests of rich apparel, bound with cords and made of cedar among thy merchandise. The ships of Tarshish did sing of thee in thy market, and thou wast replenished and made every glorious and made very glorious in the midst of the seas. Thy rowers have brought thee into great waters. The east wind hath broken thee in the midst of the seas. Thy riches and thy fares, thy merchandise, thy mariners, and thy pilots, thy caulkers, and thy occupiers of thy merchandise, and all thy men of war that are in thee, and in all thy company which is in the midst of thee shall fall into the midst of the seas in the day of your ruin. Ezekiel 27 verse 33 says this, when thy wares went forth out of the seas, thou fillest many people. Thou didst enrich the kings of the earth with the multitude of thy riches and thy merchandise. In the time when thou shalt be broken by the seas in the depths of the waters, thy merchandise and all thy company in the midst of thee shall fall. Ezekiel 27 is a prophecy concerning Tyre, and chapter 28 is a prophecy concerning the prince of Tyre, which of course turns out to be a description of Satan. So here we have, so far, the grasses, which are food grasses, rye, wheat, barley, all those things, the trees, fruit trees, apples trees, pear trees, any kind of food tree, date tree, anything that grows on a tree, anything like that. All these things are affected. Now we've got a third of the ocean where 80% of edible fish that man lives on comes from. A third part of that is instantly killed with blood, and but the blood is going to leach. It's going to leach into the rest of the waters. And at the same time, a third of all the merchant ships, a third of all the ships on the ocean are going to be destroyed. So each and every one of these things are pointing towards food and food supplies. Instantly, these things are going to be instantly gone. They're instantly going to be, they're killed off and they're reduced and they're gone away. It's not a vague, it's not a gradual thing. It don't happen over a period of time. It's instantaneous. All this stuff is going to happen. Verse 10, and the third angel sounded, and there fell a great star from heaven, burning as it were a lamp. Again, another meteorite. And it fell upon the third part of the rivers and upon the fountains of waters. Again, you have to go and do a little research on rivers. There are 165 or thereabout major rivers in the world. These major rivers are long and wide enough to be classified as major rivers with large volumes of water flowing through them every day. They have tributaries and they supply fresh water to billions of people. There are thousands of smaller rivers, but the exact number of small and large rivers in the world is difficult to determine. Rivers are everywhere. The major rivers of the world are the Amazon, the Nile, and the Yangtze rivers. The Amazon is the largest river by volume of water and has a length of 4,048 miles. The Nile has a length of 4,160 miles. And the Mississippi-Missouri River system in the United States here has a length of 3,709 miles. Most rivers have their source in lakes, springs, wetlands, and glaciers, and they flow towards the sea where they empty their waters. However, there are a few inland rivers that are called virgin rivers, and they have their source and mouth inland. The Amu Daria and the Siri Daria are examples of inland rivers. Can you tell I did a lot of online research in rivers? Nobody knows this much about rivers. Rivers are the cradles of civilization. All the major civilizations such as Mesopotamia, Indus Valley, the Egyptian and Chinese civilizations, they all developed on the banks of rivers and are used as inland waterways for transportation and for producing hydroelectric power. The uselessness of a third part of the rivers would affect all aspects of life. It would affect drinking water in a major, major, major way. All over the earth. It would affect transportation because still today goods, tons and millions of tons of goods are transported by inland waterways, not just over the ocean, but by inland waterways. Agricultural water for crops, water to all of these, and of course the small amount of food fish that we get from inland water. So everything, so here we are, we're into this now. And everything that we've read about so far has affected mankind's ability to sustain itself. his ability to have access to food, his ability to grow food, his ability to have access to water for growing food, and of course his ability to have access to water for drinking water. Everything that we've read about. So the first, when God starts this whole thing off, when he sets off on this campaign to bring judgment on the end times, on the end of the earth, he starts off with the very thing that man cannot do without: food and water. He takes care of that right away. Food and water, right out of the gate. There fell a great star burning as a lamp, and it fell upon the third part of the rivers and upon the fountains of water. Verse 11, and the name of the star is Wormwood. And the third part of the waters became wormwood, and many men died because of the waters, because they were made bitter. This star, this wormwood, the word wormwood is mentioned only here in the New Testament, but it appears 8 times in the Old Testament. Each time it's associated with bitterness, poison, and death. The Revelation star or meteor falling to the earth will be called wormwood by the inhabitants of the earth. Wormwood was a well-known bitter herb in Bible times, so by naming the star Wormwood, we are told that its effect will be to embitter the waters of the earth, so much so that the water is undrinkable. It won't be a matter of supply of a bitter taste, of simply a bitter taste to the water. It will literally be poisonous and cannot be drank. Humans can only survive a couple of days without water, and the inhabitants of the earth will be so desperate as to actually drink the poison water, causing the death of thousands, if not millions of people. Wormwood is an herb that's used in the production of absinthe, which ironically is used in alcohol products. So, you know, drink up, America. Keep at it. You're poisoning yourself with what you're drinking. Incidentally, there is already a star. We have a star and that is known. It's already out there. It's called Wormwood. And guess what? It is on a slow but sure trajectory for planet Earth. I'll let you dig into that and look up, but that star, the star that's out there that's named Wormwood already, is already on a path headed towards Earth. Verse 12, many men died. In Revelation 6:8, the opening of the fourth seal reduced the population of the earth by 1/4, if you remember when we did the math on it, and it was reduced from 6.750 million down to 5.062 billion. So here in chapter 8, it does not, because we're keeping a running tally of the people. So here in chapter 8, it just says many men died, but it doesn't apply to a number to it. So we can't add that to the running tally and the reduction of the population. Verse 12, and the fourth angel sounded, and the third part of the sun was smitten. The third part of the sun was smitten, and the third part of the moon, and the third part of the stars, so as the third part of them was darkened, and the day shone not for a third part of it, and the night likewise. Expound on this a little. Matthew 24, verse 29 says this: immediately after the tribulation of those days shall the sun be darkened, and the moon shall not give her light, and the stars shall fall from heaven, and the powers of the heavens shall be shaken. This is at the end. This description here in Matthew 24 is at the end of what Jesus in another place refers to as the Great Tribulation, which is the last 3.5 years of the 7-year tribulation period. So what he's describing as the stars falling from heaven is it comes at the end of the finish, at the completion of the whole 7-year period. This is still well within the future of what we're reading here in Revelation 8, verse 12, where the stars are dimmed by a third and not completely gone out from the sky. Exodus 10, 21 through 23 says this: and the Lord said unto Moses, stretch out thy hand toward heaven, that there may be darkness over the land of Egypt, even darkness which may be felt. And Moses stretched forth his hand toward heaven, and there was a thick darkness in all the land of Egypt for 3 days. They saw not one another, neither rose any from his place. They couldn't get out of bed. They couldn't move around for 3 days. But all the children of Israel had light in their dwellings. This darkness was achieved with sun, moon, and stars all present and apparently unaffected at all. The sun didn't cause this, the moon didn't cause this, the stars didn't. God caused this darkness to fall upon the land. Now, when it says here, the third part of them was darkened, and the day shone not for the third part of it. Again, the day shone not for the third part. The brightness of the sun was not dimmed. In other words, the sun didn't get dimmer. The light that it emits did not go down. In other words, what it's saying here, as an example, in a 24-hour period that contains 12 hours of daylight and 12 hours of dark, this would change to 8 hours of daylight and 16 hours of dark. You see what I'm saying? It's not that the things went dimmed down in nature by one third. It's that the night got a third longer, and the day, the actual sunshine hours on the earth, got shorter. This again would affect vegetation and all kinds of would make replenishing food sources and supplies extremely difficult. It's not stated how long this unbalanced day and night cycle goes on, months or maybe years or maybe even up until the end of the tribulation period. It's finished into eternity. The Bible states that there's at some point no more night at all, but it is clear that through the thousand-year millennium reign of Christ, there is day and night and planting and raising of crops on the earth. This also illustrates just how much in control of everything that God really actually is. We know that the sun is in a fixed position. The spinning of the earth is what creates the patterns of day and night. Merely speeding up or slowing down the rotation rate of the earth would not create this effect of longer days and of longer nights and shorter days on a worldwide scale. This will be accomplished entirely, 100% by the will and the almighty power of God. It will be accomplished only by His will and His power. Let me give you an example. Joshua chapter 10, verses 12 through 14. Then spake Joshua to the Lord in the day when the Lord delivered up the Amorites before the children of Israel. And he said in the sight of Israel's son, stand thou still upon Gibeon, and thou moon in the valley of Ajalon. And the sun stood still, and the moon stayed, until the people had avenged themselves upon their enemies. Is not this written in the book of Jasher? So the sun stood still in the midst of heaven and hasted not to go down about a whole day. And there was no day like that before it or after it that the Lord hearkened unto the voice of a man, for the Lord fought for Israel. Here is the story of Joshua in the battle, and he asked for the sun to stand still, and it did. We know that the sun is in a fixed position and the earth spins. The sun stays there. It stays where it's at. The earth spins and creates day and night, the sunrise and sunset. Now, we know that. That's a fact. That is an absolute fact. There's no recounting that, no matter what the flat earther people say. We know the sun is fixed and the earth spins. What God literally had to do was stop the spinning of the earth for 24 hours. He had to stop the earth from spinning for a period of 24 hours. We also know that the spinning of Earth, it does not generate gravity. But if the spinning were to stop completely and suddenly, it would wreak havoc on the force of the gravity on the Earth. So not only did God have to stop the Earth from spinning so that it would remain daylight until they got finished fighting, but He also had to make sure that nothing floated away. He also had to make sure that all the forces that are generated by the spinning of the Earth didn't wreak havoc on the other things on the Earth. He had to make sure, in other words, that the earth stayed intact for this whole entire period. And he could do that because that's well within the power that he has. That is well within the power that he holds and controls over the face of the earth. He literally controls every single thing about us and about the earth and about all the physics and everything that is applied to the earth. So if he wants to make the sun shine a third less on all the parts of the earth so it will affect food supplies, because like I said, up until this point, everything we've read about is food shortages and water shortages. So now he changes the way the sun shines on the earth, which feeds our plants and feeds our animals and gives us vitamin D and does all kinds of things. The sunshine, it does all kinds of, but mainly it makes things grow. It makes food supplies grow. It makes all these things. So he's taken away most of the food supplies of the earth, and then he's changed the sunshine on the earth to make it probably close to impossible to grow more food supplies back, to plant more trees, to get more wheats and grains to grow. So everything he's done so far affects the food. It affects the very thing that man needs to survive, the food and the water and the ability to grow more food and water. The third part of the moon and the third part of the stars and the third part of them was darkened, and the day shone not for a third part of it, and the night likewise. Verse 13, and I beheld and heard an angel flying through the midst of heaven, saying with a loud voice, woe, woe, woe. And he did not repeat himself three times for no reason. Woe, woe, woe to the inhabitants of the earth, by reason of the other voices of the trumpet of the three angels, which are yet to sound. So here we read this angel flying. Angels fly. Let me go ahead and read my notes. Angels fly. They move from side to side through the heavens and the skies. They ascend to the earth and descend. They travel between heaven and earth, and they take on the appearance of humans, and they do all this without wings. Paul says to be careful that you entertain strangers because you might be entertaining angels unaware. And he didn't say, and you'll know it because they'll have wings. Angels don't have wings. They can fly. They don't need wings to fly. They don't need wings to ascend and descend from the heavens to the earth. They don't need wings to take on the form of a human and come and be entertained by human beings. Why would Paul say that we would entertain angels unaware? Because they're checking up on us. They're coming down here and they're visiting us. They're seeing how we treat people. They're seeing how we live. I mean, just think about it. You invite somebody, you pick up a hitchhiker. That's the most common thing I say about this. You pick up a hitchhiker. The hitchhiker's in your car for whatever, 30 minutes, maybe 5, maybe 2 hours, depends on where you're going, how far you're traveling. Well, the conversation's going to flow. You're going to get to know. And believe me, if you're entertaining an angel, he's going to be full of questions. He's going to be talkative. He's going to be a chatterbox. He's going to be talking because he's there to find out about you. He's there to find out how you treat people, how you feel about things, how you think about things, how you interact with other people, how you drive your car. They're checking up on us, people. That's what they're doing. They're coming and checking up on us. It's a test. It's a test to see how we're doing. It's a test. You're entertaining angels unaware, and they don't come with wings. You won't know them because they don't have wings, because angels don't have wings. But they're able to do all these things. They're able to fly and do all these things. John 1:51 says, and he saith unto him, verily, verily, I say unto you, hereafter you shall see heaven open, and the angels of God ascending and descending upon the Son of Man. Hebrews 13:2, be not forgetful, entertain strangers, for thereby some have entertained angels unawares. They had no idea what they were doing. Revelation 14:6 says, I saw another angel fly in the midst of heaven, having the everlasting gospel to preach unto them that dwell on the earth, and to every nation and kindred and tongue and people. Verse 13 in Revelation 8. And I beheld and heard an angel flying through the midst of heaven, saying with a loud voice, woe, woe, woe to the inhabitants of the earth, by reason of the other voices of the trumpet of the three angels, which are yet to sound. So we're 4 trumpets into the 7. There's 7 of them. We've went through the 7 vials. Now we're a little over halfway through the 7 trumpets. So far, everything that has come on the face of the earth has been to affect the food supplies, the grass, the trees, the fish, the oceans, the rivers, the water supply. And then he fixes the sun so it's very difficult or maybe even impossible to regrow and to replenish food sources. That is Revelation 8. And that went pretty quick, went pretty steady. I hope if some of you have any questions, I hope that you'll post them to me on YouTube. I appreciate every one of you that watch this. I appreciate every one of you that share these. If you watch them, if you enjoy them, if you're learning anything, if God is blessing you in any way whatsoever, please share them. If you have Facebook, if you have Twitter, whatever you have, share them, pass them on. Because it's my, you know, I've said this many times, I stole this prayer from Steve Hess, that God would help me so that I could help others. And I pray that this has been a help to you, it's inspiring you to read your Bible. If it don't do anything else, I want it to inspire you to read your Bible, because that's what this is all about. This is all about reading the Bible. It's all about studying the Bible. It's all about staying within the confines of the Bible. It's all about believing what the Bible says. Now, I read to you some tonight from the book of Tobit and from the book of Enoch. Does that mean that I stand by them as canon, as Word of God? No, I do not. Have I read them both? Yes, I have, along with the book of Jasher and along with a lot of other things. I read a lot of things, but that don't matter. I don't trust my eternal life to anything but this. I don't look to the book of Enoch to give me eternal life. I don't look to the book of Tobit to give me salvation. I don't look to the book of Jasher to find out what I need to do and to get try and draw closer to Christ Jesus. This is what He gave us for Him. Can you delve off and read other things? Of course, but be careful. Again, I hope this is a blessing. I hope that you're learning. Pray for me. I pray for everybody that watches these. And until next week, God bless you greatly.